Last time I was here speaking at your Saturday night service, is a breakthrough for me that I've talked about ever since then, in just believing that God was going to show me more, and it happened. And I believe this time it's not so much a breakthrough for me, but a breakthrough for you. And so before I begin the message, I do want to say on your way out, we do have a product table of some things. If you have interest in deliverance, this little book here is a biblical guidebook to deliverance. I really want to encourage you. You want to learn about it. You want to learn how to recognize some of the signs. This is just a little bit about it. My introduction to deliverance, how it happened. I love that story. It's funny, too. I was so stupid. I can't go into it, but I think you'll die laughing. Deliverance, a New Testament reality, theology of deliverance, deliverance in the history of the church. Can a Christian be demonized? Signs of demonization. Deliverance is part of the process of sanctification. Curses, inner vows, soul ties, and generational curses, all one chapter. And a woman read that chapter. That's where she turned first. Read five pages, saw something she had done. It caused her to go into deep repentance of the Holy Spirit. As she's repenting, her daughter, who's in her 20s with schizophrenia, gets instantly healed. Because the mother had opened the family up to just this attack through her own sin that she had done. And she, when she's reading it, she realized, oh my gosh, I did that. And then she repented, and her daughter gets totally healed, schizophrenia. Satan and demons, the occult and demonization, Freemasonry, ministering deliverance, guidelines from ministering deliverance. It's all here. This next book is written to refute the book Strange Fire by John MacArthur. It's the same color scheme. It's got the same table of contents that he had in his book. I just took the exact same table of contents and just gave the other side. And this is the newest book I've written, Authority to Heal. This has got the most thorough documentation, biblically and theologically speaking, about the whole belief in healing, and really especially trying to deal with the cessationist arguments that very conservative Christians have and the liberal arguments that nothing like that happens today, that others. And this is one of my favorite books right now. It's the second fastest book I ever wrote. And the first part of it deals with, I shared it in a Baptist church in Portuguese, and they had enough English speakers that they bought the whole case I had with me. But the first part is dealing with theologies and practices that hurts faith for healing. And the second part of the book is how understanding what we need to do and building a faith and understanding how to cooperate with God and the ways of God, that we have more more of an atmosphere of faith. And so I don't want to deal with the second part because I've been trying to model that this week. But I do want to deal with the first part. I deal with Paul's thorn in the flesh. I deal with the overemphasis on sovereignty. We blame God for the only thing that's happened is what you want to happen, when I believe there's a whole lot more he'd like to see happen. But our understanding of sovereignty is we blame him. And I don't think that's the issue. The big lie about faith, talk about harmful hype, talk about the opposite of hype when we don't testify to what God is doing. It hurts the service. It robs God of his glory. Expecting too much or not enough, we're sometimes accused of what's called in theological terms overrealized eschatology, which just basically means you're expecting God to do now what's reserved for the millennium. And I don't think I have an overrealized eschatology. I think my detractors have an underrealized eschatology, and they're not expecting enough in the present. That, and they've pushed off into the millennium things that God has made covenant promises to us for the present, not just for the millennium. And so that's one of the things we deal with, the deception of cessationism, those things have ended, the deistic or liberal worldview that nothing really happens, it's supernatural. Sickness is my cross to bear, and the bad theology that goes along with that. And then mistaking emotionalism for faith, and then overreaction to the word of faith position, where we throw the baby out with the bathwater, and then making a transitional section to, now that we've removed the rubble, how do we rebuild, how do we build the wall of faith, and what can we do? And that's the second part of the book. That's all I have, are these four, more copies of them, but they're out there on the table, and Justin will be there at the end of the message. Here you go, Justin. We don't have that many, so. I really was trying to figure out, God, what do you want to do tonight? And I believe I'm supposed to speak on the power of the testimony, and but two ways, and so it's almost like two messages. One deals with healing, and the other deals with renewal. And so I want to start with the passage about healing. I talked about the power of the testimony one night, and but the Lord didn't lead me to share a section of that message that I want to right now. And so if you have your Bibles, I want you to open your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, and we're going to be looking at verse 19, but to put it in context, we'll begin in verse 17, but the most important verse we're actually going to draw your attention to is verse 19. Now, my intention is to tell you three stories from four passages of Scriptures, because one of the stories is, I'm going to repeat it from Luke and in Matthew's Gospel, but it's the same story, except Matthew tells us something Luke alludes to, but Luke doesn't tell us what the woman actually said who had the issue of blood. And I believe that in this Scripture, you know, often we talk about exegesis when you're drawing out of the text what's in the text, and eisegesis is when you're reading in the text something that's not in the text. Now, that's easier to see with a specific text, but what if we don't just look at a proof text, so to speak, but we're looking at a larger context, many texts. For example, in John's Gospel, there are seven signs. Six of the seven signs are preceded by an act of obedience before the miracle takes place. Well, if you look at the larger context, you can build more of an evidence for the importance of acts of obedience. When we look at the Gospels, I think we can see the importance of testimony, and particularly from these four stories, and that's in Luke and also in Matthew. Four passages, but three stories. Now, I'm going to admit that the connection between the first story and the second story, it's my opinion. I can't say the text tells me that. But then when I add the third story, I think it really solidifies the power of the testimony to create faith, to bring about healing. The importance of this is you need to know that every testimony that you hear of a healing in Jesus' name belongs to you, because you're part of the body of Christ. It doesn't have to be your story. You just pass it along. Where there's a church that understands the power of the testimony, that they are not ashamed and they're bold enough to tell their friends, to tell the unbelievers, to tell their barbers, tell their hairdressers, tell their doctors, tell their nurses, tell the people they, you know, just to tell when they can, as that begins to happen, there begins to be even a faith that's created by those who are not yet even saved. Case in point is the story, of course, Redding has developed this testimony culture in Redding, California, at Bethel. And there's a woman who was a hairdresser, wasn't saved. And so many people from Bethel would tell her when she would do their hair, about the healings that were taking place, especially the healings of cancer and things. And so one day a woman sat down in her chair to have her hair done, and she's distraught, and the hairdresser said, "What's wrong?" And she said, "Well, I just found out I got cancer." And the hairdresser, who's not saved, said, "You need to get up to Bethel Church because they don't tolerate cancer. I've heard so many stories of people being healed." And so you got an unbelieving believer. I believe that there are unbelieving believers. And I also sadly say sometimes we got believing. Well, I got it backwards. So we got a believing unbeliever. And sadly to say, sometimes we have unbelieving believers.
Right.
And one of the things you can do to change that culture is the power of the testimony. So I just want to challenge you to share the stories. Now, I believe this principle is so true by experience. But I was so excited one day when I just realized this from the scripture, that not only do I know this to be true from experience, I can prove it to you from the scripture. It's in the Word. This principle I'm teaching, it's not just what we've seen happen today, but it's also in the Word of God, and that's what we want to look at. Now, when we get to the last two stories, the middle story, the three, and the third story, it, I believe, is going to be very, very clear that it was the power of the testimony that gave the faith that the request would be so specific. So let's look. Luke chapter 6, verse 17 through 19. Oh, wait, just put your hand in a minute. I got something I got to tell you before we start. Because I want to apply this principle. I have faith tonight for something really good to happen. And the reason why is the power of the testimony. I was called out of the meeting yesterday when Justin was speaking because we had a meeting with another church I'm a spiritual father of. And they said, "It's extremely important. We must talk to you." And the only time we could really work it was while Justin was speaking. So Tom and I met right over there in that room. And there's about six people on the staff of Cedra Church. It's down in West Palm Beach, Florida. It's a Hispanic church. And they were just telling me, just overjoyed, just one after the other, telling me these stories of how that something had happened. Said, "You've been here twice. You've done two schools here. But this last time when you came, you didn't come as a part of Global Awakening. You didn't come to do a school. You came as our spiritual father. And you ministered to us out of that being our father. And something happened more than in those two whole schools that happened. And some of the people you prayed for, they're having miracles, not just healings, but like creative miracles almost on a daily basis." He said, "Ever since," it's 2 weeks ago we were there, he said, "Ever since 2 weeks ago, every day there is healings and a miracle taking place every day. We're seeing breakthroughs like we have never seen before." And she showed me, she actually showed me on Skype, this testimony. She says, the woman had severe scoliosis, and they had the number of degrees off up the top and down at the bottom, went both ways. And then after the prayer, went back to the doctor and how it had straightened up. And before two x-rays, before and after. Just the time, the stories that they've got evidence of from the doctors has just been amazing. And I realized that, you know, our conference is over. I'm not here as part of the conference right now.
That's right. That's right.
I'm here as your spiritual father. Yeah. And I believe that God is going to release something. I know one of the guys we went over in our room, so we prayed for all the pastors and people who was there on their staff, some of the key leaders in a room. One of those guys got such an anointing. He himself, not just the church, he himself has had healings every day for 2 weeks when he's prayed for people. There's not been one day that he's not had a healing. Now, God didn't do that to everybody, but some of the people that happened to him, but the whole church received an increase of anointing. I believe God is going to do something tonight, an increase And so the whole message is going to, it may not make sense, this is about the power of the testimony. And I just want that testimony to create a hunger and a faith in you that cries out, God, what you did to Cedra, do to New Life City. God, what we heard that you did 2 weeks ago, do it again. Do it again. I believe he will. So now, having said that, I'm ready to go start preaching. Luke 6:17, he went down with them and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea, from Jerusalem, and from the coast of Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Those troubled with evil spirits were cured. And the people, this is the verse, this is it. This is where we focus our attention. And the people all tried to touch him because power was coming from him and healing them all. Power was coming from him and healing them all. And for that reason, they were all trying to touch him. Now, two chapters over, in the 8th chapter of Luke, in the middle of verse 42, we have one of the most powerful stories about healing. It's probably been told more than any other one story about healing in the Bible. It's about the woman with the issue of blood, because it's such an emphasis on faith. How many of you have heard her, the woman with the issue of blood, as a message on faith and faith for healing? I mean, it's just a classic passage of Scripture. But I wanted to raise the question, where did she get that faith? How did she come by such faith? And I believe the Lord has shown me that that kind of faith she had was rooted in the testimony of what had happened out on the plain, on that level place, where everybody that was touching him was being healed because power was coming out of him and healing them all. So we pick up in the middle of verse 42 of chapter 8 of Luke. As Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. It's really interesting that Mark tells us a little more. He says the woman had spent all she had on the physicians and was no better. There's this history that goes all the way back to the New Testament physician named Luke, who doesn't mention that the physicians couldn't help her. There's just this code of honor amongst physicians that they don't cut each other down. Luke doesn't tell us that she spent all of her money on her doctors and she is no better, but Mark did. Verse 44, she came up behind him and touched. Now, King James says the hem of his garment, but in NIV it says the edge of his cloak. Now, that's important because as Luke tells the story and as Matthew tells the story, that detail is in both of those gospels, that she touched the edge of his cloak. And immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. And when they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding against and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me," which is exactly what was happening in Luke 6. For power was coming out of him and healing them all. Verse 47, this important verse. Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. Now I ask the question, why could she not go unnoticed? I believe because when Jesus looked around that great mass of people that had been pressing in around him, there was others touching him, but they weren't touching him in faith. She touched him in faith. I believe on the plain they were coming in faith. And power was coming out of him and healing them all. She touched him. And the reason why she can't hide herself was that she was trembling. That power that he felt come out of her himself, when it went into her, she's the one that stood there looking like this. And realizing that she could not hide herself, she came forward. Now, Mark says she came forward. trembling with fear. Maybe she was fearful because, you know, sometimes that power feels so strong, it's scary. Or maybe she's scared because she got caught stealing the anointing. She didn't ask permission. Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. And in the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. In the presence of this great crowd, she explained why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Luke doesn't tell us what she said, but Matthew does. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." Now, we have the story of the plane out on a level place. Power is coming out of him and healing them all. I believe that's testimony is what gave her the idea, I just need to touch, even just touch his clothes, and I'll be healed. The idea for that, I believe, is connected to the story of what had happened, the testimony. And if the people hadn't have told what God had done, what Jesus had done, who is God, out on the plain, I don't think she would have had that idea. Or neither would she have had the faith for that to occur. And her faith, I believe, was created by the power of the testimony. Now, I can't prove that, but I think that opinion is going to be stronger as we look a little farther. So now let's look at what Matthew tells us about this same story in Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 through 22. Just then a woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. Would you say that with me? And touched the
edge of his cloak.
That's important. She said to herself, this is what Matthew tells us that Luke refers to in verse 47. She explained why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Matthew just gives us the answer. What did she tell him? She told him, she had said to herself, if I only touch his cloak, I will be healed. Jesus turned and saw her. Take heart, daughter, he said, your faith has healed you. And the woman was healed from that moment. Now, you might say, well, Randy, that's your opinion, and that's possible, but you might be reading too much into it. You might be eisegeting instead of exegeting. You might be reading into the text rather than bringing it out of the text, but I don't think so on this next one, because there's one more story that we need to put these three together, because I think these three are all of them tied together. It's Matthew chapter 14. Verse 34 through 36. And by the way, Jesus has fed the 5,000 in chapter 14. And then as these disciples are sent to the area they're sent to go to, which they're going to go over to the Gerasenes, or at Gennesaret. But on the way over, they're in the middle of a battle, and there's conflict. And there's a storm that comes against them. And I believe that storm was not just a natural storm, because Jesus rebuked it the same way he does a demon. I believe that the enemy was not wanting the disciples to come into their area. I believe the powers did not want the power of the kingdom to be coming into that region where they had such a stronghold. But Jesus prevails. Now we pick up in verse 34. And when they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret. What I want to make a point of is this. Where they were going to, there was opposition to it. But there was great power that happened when they got there. So when they had crossed over, they came and landed at Gennesaret. And in verse 35, and when the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. People brought all their sick to him. And what happened? This is the point I want you to get. They sent word to all the country. And then they brought, the people brought all their sick to him in verse 36 and begged him to let the sick, what? Just touch the edge of his cloak. And all who touched him were healed. That is a very specific request. They could have said, oh, dear, oh Lord, just your presence. Just walk by them, they can be healed. Let your shadow be over them. Oh, Lord, just spit on them. We've heard about you've done that sometimes. Lord, just lay your hands on them. We've heard so much about you laying your hands on people and they're getting healed. Or there are so many things. Oh, Lord, let them touch your hair. Let them touch your feet. Oh, God, just let them touch your hand. But none of that. It is so specific. Just let them touch the edge of your cloak. Why? Because that story had spread. That she had told them, I said to myself, I can just touch him. And in the telling of the story, we find both Luke and Matthew, that little detail, as the story was being told, and she came up behind him, and she touched just the edge of his cloak. And as soon as she touched the edge of his cloak, power came out of him and healed her. So when they get to another area, a long ways away, that story has gone ahead of them. What if the people had not told the story? They wouldn't have made that request. The faith that's behind that request is actually created by the power of the testimony of what he had done and what she had done and how the power had came and healed him. And they believed. Just let them touch the edge of your cloak. And when they did, they were all healed. Power of the testimony for healing. I want to just go for this right now because I want to do two things tonight's service. I usually don't like to go for two at the same time. I usually don't like to go for impartation and renewal and healing on the same night. But I see this common theme, and so I want to. I want to show the video. And actually, part of this video, the last story was the last time I was here last year. And this story, I've put this together, and this was just so powerful. To encourage people to believe in the power of words of knowledge to also to be used to create faith. So it's a Reading compilation, isn't it? So you guys ready? And before you show it, though, I want to say this. If you have anything like what you see, God can heal you too tonight. By the power of the testimony. But you don't have to have the same thing. God just may create through what you see so much faith that you get healed. As you watch a testimony, maybe something different, but you say, man, if he can do that, he can touch me. I believe that the power of this video of the testimony is going to cause some of you to get healed. And I believe it so much that as soon as it's over, I want you to stand up and try to check things out. Whatever you need to do to see if you... And I don't want you to do it for one time, two times, three times. All right, no, that still hurts. No. At least 2 minutes.
All right.
At least 2 minutes. I know I've seen some people... I was down in Brazil. It was really bad, kind of like a jungle area we were in. It really was, man. And this guy has a pin in his collarbone, and he's got metal in it, and that pin has broke. And it causes him a lot of pain. You know, I never understood this passage where it says, I believe it was Peter seeing faith. I said, what does that mean, seeing faith? I know now, because... As I see people, we've shown a video just like I'm going to do here. And I saw people trying, but I saw this man. And when everybody else pretty much had kind of quit, he would not. He just kept going for it. Now, not that going for it a long time is all necessarily expression of faith, but I don't know how to explain it. But when I looked at him, I saw that man is full of faith. And he didn't quit in a minute or 2 minutes. He must have kept trying to do something he couldn't do for probably 10 minutes. I mentioned this before. I think this week we were in Rio de Janeiro, and we were near the favelas, the slums. And actually, while we're preaching, you can hear the bullets going off, the guns going off. Just right across the wall from where we're at is the favelas. And one of the guys that we're praying for has got an X-ray of a bullet, you know, and he's paralyzed from a bullet he'd received. But anyway, that particular night, people were going for it, and one of the words was dealing with shoulders and not able to lift up your arms. A lot of people had already been healed, but this one guy had 16 screws in his spine, two great metal bars, or actually four, two this way and two this way. He tried. I think I said just for a minute or two, he tried. Some people are already healed, minute or two. Man, they're healed already, but he wasn't. He didn't want to cause people to be attention drawn from the speaker, myself, to himself. So he walks out the side door and is standing in the hallway and where he can hear. And for the next 30 minutes, the man would not give up. They're frozen. They can't go up. The metal won't let it do it. It pinched so bad in his back. And for 30 minutes, he just kept trying. And then full range of motion came in. Yeah. There's something about this. When God gives, I'll just put it this way. That faith was not his attainment. That faith was his grace. I'll say it again. That faith demonstrated in that 30 minutes of not quitting. I do not think it was that man's attainment that he had come in. That I believe that faith for that night for him was a gift from God. It was a gift of faith that he was moving in, that this is going to happen. And it did. All right, so now, you guys ready? Let's watch the video.
Eli?
Yeah.
What was your problem? What have you been healed of?
A metal plate sticking out of my arm for years and in front of everyone.
Like this, off her arm. It's always been that way.
It just went down.
Go flat.
Yeah.
In an instant, I watched it go flat. As we were praying over her, it disappeared. The plate's gone. She's always had that. It's gone.
It's gone.
It's gone.
The
you could see it sticking out this far.
All the screws that had come out were in my muscle. They were embedding, and so can I just?
It stuck out like a mound on her
like,
arm. Always.
It was gnarly.
And
yeah.
I watched it go thunk.
Since like 2006. So
for 8 years or 9 years.
Yeah.
She's
had this huge plate coming out of her arm. She's had this huge plate coming out of her arm, like a mound on her arm that was so visible. And I watched it as we were praying. Instantly, it went thunk and it was gone. Praise God.
Can I say one other thing?
Yeah.
In 2012, I got saved at the Healing Rooms in Santa Maria, and I got healed of HIV, and my heart valves got healed, and I've got the proof, the medical proof to prove it,
yes.
And so I didn't think God would do more for me, and then they stood up and prayed for my arm, and he healed me again, so.
I had a disease in my ear, and it's called cholesteatoma, and it ate away all the ear bones and the eardrum in my left ear, and I could only hear very loud noises like tractors and airplanes, but I couldn't hear the TV, and I couldn't talk on the phone, and I couldn't hear my very quiet friend. And this weekend, I think that just changed, and I think I can hear out of my ear just fine, and I can hear little tiny noises like rubbing my fingers together in this ear, and that is a total change, completely.
So you said you had no ear bones, no eardrum, and you could only hear very loud sounds,
yeah.
And now you're saying you can hear a gentle rub of your own fingers in the midst of a crowd, is that right?
Yeah, in this noisy room, I can hear my little fingers and I can hear my quiet friend just fine.
Incredible. Praise God.
That's my foot, my crooked foot. That was my crooked
foot. That was her foot.
My back. So when my foot got healed, I don't have any more back pain either.
Okay. On a scale of 0 to 10, 10 is excruciating. What was the level of your pain before you got healed?
Can I say over 10?
Yes.
Because a lot of the times, like, I couldn't even make dinner for my husband or do anything with my grandkids.
What's your pain level now?
It's 0.
Hallelujah!
Woo!
I was one of the people that stood up when he said crowbar, and everybody kind of giggled, but I stood up because God had told me earlier when we were in praise and worship, it's the crowbar. You're still holding on to that. A reason is that I suffered domestic violence. And I was beaten with a crowbar. My neck was broken. My jaw was broken. I suffered loss of hearing, and this year I couldn't hear at all. I wear a hearing aid. The associate pastor and his wife could attest, they're my in-laws, they're my brother's niece, so they're mine, that I can't hear. But we were in praise and worship. He said, now I'm gonna wash you clean. And I was there, I was kind of embarrassed, but I was just soaking, it was just getting wet. And I said, I better take off my hearing aid or else I'm not going to be able to hear. It's not going to work because they get wet. They don't work. So I took it off, and then I was saying, wait, I could hear. I don't know how good I could hear, but I've never heard you before preach, even with a microphone, without the hearing aid. And tonight, I didn't wear the hearing aid. It went right into my Bible pocket, and I haven't put it back on. Because it was the crowbar, I guess, that when it beat me and broke my neck and my jaw, and God healed me inside my heart, because he said, it's not the hearing that you want. It's the healing inside that you want. But I'm going to give it to you anyway.
Amen. Now, the Lord had spoken to her and told her before, is this correct? Before I gave the word crowbar,
amen.
He told you he was going to heal the crowbar issue,
yes,
for you tonight.
Yes.
And then we get this word crowbar. So thank you for coming and giving that testimony. And thank you, Lord. Yes, thank you.
I have to say, out of all the testimonies we have about healing and related to words of knowledge, that one is the most powerful. Wherever we show up, people are just blown away that, because God had spoken to her before. He said, I'm going to heal your crowbar issue tonight. I was convinced that I actually said, I'm almost certain this next word is not God. I'm almost certain I'm missing God because I hear the word crowbar. What do you think that did for her? I believe there'll be words of knowledge tonight. The team, your local team, the local church ministry team, we want to give you a chance later, and others that's been to some of the schools and things to flow in word of knowledge. But what I want to do now is everybody stand up. and I'm going to set on my Fitbit watch my time. And the stopwatch is going to start right now. And you have 2 minutes to test things out. If you need to go out and run to check out if you got healed of your asthma, go do it. If you need to bend, if you need to lay down, if there's something you can't do, if you get to start coughing, if you lay down on your back, then lay down on your back. Whatever it is you can't do. If you have trouble hearing, my friend Ed Hosha is my spiritual son in Brazil. He's had over 130 healing, maybe I think it's 180 now actually, that he'll tell him, if you have trouble hearing, start snapping your fingers. And I've just seen it. He has a real gift for hearing, healing of ears. My one boy recently, he started thinking, oh my gosh, my eyes are getting worse. I get prayed for healing in my eyes, and they're worse. Everything's getting blurred because he had his glasses on. When your eyes get healed and you don't need them, it looks blurry looking through your glasses. He took his glasses off, he could see fine. We've seen God heal blind eyes. And so one guy down in Brazil, he didn't have an optic nerve connected to the back of the eyeball. And God healed him with no optic nerve connected to the eyeball. And God healed it. We've seen God heal a boy in Odessa who didn't have an auditory nerve. Two doctors, it's been burned out by high fever. You don't have an auditory nerve. And he got his hearing. It's a creative miracle. So just keep going. Keep trying. Don't do it. Just come on now. Just don't give me half. Effort. I want 13 more seconds of diligent trying it out. That man, his testimony night was his healed in his leg and the metal, can't even feel it anymore. We had 5,000 testimonies over that now. Okay. All right. Now, everybody, here it is. We're testifying to what God's doing. It doesn't have to be done. But we want to testify, if you're at least 80% better, I want you to wave both hands over your head and keep waving them for 1 minute. Just to check it out, because you'll see some of them are already healed. There's been no prayer. Just watching the video. We said it would happen. It is a testimony. It is. Just keep waving those hands. I'm going to start counting right now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. How about in this section here? 8, 9, 10. Thank you, Lord. 11. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, how many of you say, I'm not 80%, but something's happening? Maybe you're feeling his power come in you or on you. Maybe it's getting better, but you're not 80% yet. But something is happening. Put only one hand. See, this means I'm at least 80%. This means God's touched me. I'm getting better, but I'm not 80%. How many of you can say, hey, keep, because I'm going to pray for you, but you know God's beginning to touch you. Just put one hand in the air and hold it up. Now, it's all right. It's okay. How many we have? 10 just got healed?
I had 14.
You had 14? Okay. Say 14 healings. We thank God for that.
Yeah.
It's all right. But I want to point out something. There was no prayer for healing. We have not even prayed for healing. Well, it was just a declaration. And the faith and the power of the testimony.
Yeah.
Now, I believe beyond the power of the testimony, there is power in prayer. And at the end, we lay hands on people. It says you lay your hands on the people and shall recover. But now we're just going to pray. God's going to watch over his word. Father, God's beginning to. And by the way, you may not feel anything, but once we start praying, if God starts to touch you, put your hand in the air. It's just like, let that hand be like a lightning rod. I just need to know, because if I don't see any hands in one section, I'll just go on over to the others, because there's no one to pray for God. I can only bless what God's doing. All right, Father, I thank you for what you're doing. I thank you for the 14 that already got healed, and I thank you for the others that's in the process of being healed. And I bless your presence, and I bless these men and women and boys and girls. I bless the ones, God, their anointing of your spirit is upon them. I bless what you're doing. I just say, more, Lord, multiply your power. Increase the anointing. May the power of your spirit that came out of Jesus and went into that those people begin to flow into the ones tonight. In the name of Jesus, I bless them. I bless what you're doing. I bless your anointing. I come in agreement based upon 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 through 20. And we say, amen. We say, amen, God. We say, amen to what you're doing in the name of Jesus. Glorify your name. Father, we want to see a lot happen tonight in many ways, not just people getting healed, but people receiving an anointing for healing. God, we pray in the name of Jesus for you to do things in answer to his prayer as he prayed in that upper room discourse. And when he went out in John 17, prayed for us. God, in the name of Jesus, we know that the Spirit has been given that we might be able, in the name of Jesus, to see things happen that brings glory to the Father. And so, in the name of Jesus, I bless what God is doing in this place. Now, one more time, those of you who, if you waved your hands a while ago, don't wave them again unless you get healed of something else. If you get healed of something else, that's another healing. We'll count it. Now, if you weren't at least 80%, check it out now. Take 30 seconds. Check it out. And if you are at least 80% or more, better. Because I want you to know, I got a word of knowledge. I got healed myself of 4 herniated discs. I've had 9 herniated discs in my life, in my back. And I got healed of 4 of them because a guy got a word of knowledge for me. And as soon as he started praying, I was 80% better, but it wasn't 100%. But I had complete confidence because of how it happened that I was going to be totally healed. And within a matter of days, that 80% was 100%. So that's a significant amount. All right, everybody, it's at least 80% that since I prayed, wave both hands over your head. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. 7 more. How many of you are saying, Randy, I'm getting close. I'm getting close, but I'm not 80% here. But just put your hand up again. I want to see. I don't, you know, if I was praying for you as an individual and you told me, man, I'm getting better, but I'm not, I wouldn't quit. I treat a crowd exactly the way I do an individual. So if there's some more of you say, man, I'm improving, I'm getting better. I just need you to put your hand in the air because there's no need to pray if he's not doing anything. But if he's doing something, we need to bless what he's doing, and he is. Thank you, God. Now just keep your hands up. Almighty God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you and I praise you and I give you glory. God, we contend for your glory. We believe in your power to heal. We believe in the sovereign visitation for the glory, for the power to flow into people's bodies in the name of Jesus. And God, we believe that, Father, you are worthy of greater praise and greater glory than we have at this point. God, this is not enough. I'm just saying, Lord, it's not enough. I believe you want to do more than this. I believe Jesus wants you to receive more glory. And so, Father, we bless them. Holy Spirit, come. Angels of God, come. Come with new body parts. In the name of Jesus, heal. In Jesus' name, your healing virtue to flow into them. In the name of Jesus, I command the pain to leave. In Jesus' name, I command function to be restored, movement to be restored. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. God, we bless what you're doing. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, for where there's metal, where there's something that's messed up, where the parts have been removed, parts have been destroyed. We pray what you did for that woman who had that disease in her ears and no bones and no eardrum. You had to do a creative miracle. We pray, Lord, that there'd be a miracle. We just testified what you did at Sidra Church in West Palm Beach. Not just healings, but miracles are taking place like they've never seen in the history of their church. God, they're so excited what you're doing. We want that same thing, God. We believe you're no respecter of persons. We believe you want to take churches into this. So in Jesus' name, glorify the Father, and may Jesus' name be glorified as well. Check it out one more time. If you got healed of something else, or now you're at least 80% better, I want you again for a 1 minute, lift your hands and cross them to your wrists, cross your wrists. If you got healed since the last prayer or during that prayer, wave both hands over your head to your wrist cross. There's one more, two more, three more, four more, five more, six more, seven more, eight more. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I don't know if I counted you or not. Nine more. Thank you for letting me know. I thought that was a new one. Thank you, Jesus. Nine more now. 30 some odd healings. There's one back there. There's another one back there. 31. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Now, real quick, I'd like to get, because I got other things we want to do, I'd like to get five testimonies of people that you were in either enough pain that you needed to be on Percocet, morphine, some other narcotic to kill the pain, or there was something you couldn't do, you'd lost function of, and now you can. You can say, I couldn't do this without pain. Now I can do it without pain. I could only go to here. Now I got all the way to here. Can I have five people like that? And I'd like, come on. And I'd like for it to be, it's something you've had for some time. It's not something you started 2 days ago or a week ago. Come on. Give God the glory. Don't touch his glory by withholding the testimony if you've got something.
I do love the Lord, and I've loved him all my life, and I have been a Christian all my life, and I love being a Christian.
All right, I like all of that, okay, but you got to get to the healing because we're running out short of time.
I was prayed for last week by one of these ladies, and then some more ladies prayed for me, and it was to keep from shaking. I shook all the time. The doctor couldn't even figure out why. They never did figure out why I shook.
How many years did you shake like that?
2.
2 years?
Yeah.
All right.
And now I'm healed. I'm healed. I quit shaking.
When did it happen?
That
2 days ago?
No, that night. Last week.
Last week?
Yeah.
You've been in for a whole week. That's shaking.
Yeah.
Stopped. Now, I know that sometimes there's a shaking. It's God.
I have to go. Thank you, God. Get away from me, devil.
All right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on up, guys. Just do this quickly.
Okay, so I've lived with asthma ever since I can remember, ever since I was a baby. And 2 nights ago, the Lord healed me of my asthma. I actually threw away all the medicine that I had. So it's just, you know, it's really great just, you know, to finally breathe. It was so, yesterday and today, I didn't realize how much muscle I was using to actually breathe. So at first I was like breathing really heavy, and you know, it was just like I just had to tell myself, you know, calm down, okay. You know, the Lord gave you new lungs, so I had to just like, you know, learn to adjust with it. So, but I'm completely healed, and you know, I haven't used my medicine. Usually when I wake up in the morning, I have to use my inhaler, and for the past 2 days, I haven't had a problem. So,
amen. Thank you, Lord.
Well, 4 nights ago, I had my hearing cured after at least 10 years of construction. And tonight, I rolled my ankle about 6 months ago. It's been very tender, and I have complete range of motion and no pain whatsoever.
Amen. Thank you,
complete,
Lord.
Complete blessing. Thank you.
Thank
Lord.
You.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.
Last fall, I had an injury in my pelvic joint. the inflammation was so much I couldn't walk up a flight of stairs, which I just did now. Coming in, I had some taking some medication. It healed it to a point, but I still couldn't walk upstairs because every time I took a left step, it would hurt. So you saw me walk up.
Thank you, Lord. All right. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. That's pretty good. Yes. Amen. Now, normally we would go more into healing, but we have that at the very end. But I feel like we're supposed to go for two things tonight, both with the power of the testimony. I want to talk to you about some manifestations we have seen and what they meant. And the fruit. And how God touched people. We didn't understand what it meant. Now we understand a little better. But for our text, I want to go to the book of Acts. In chapter 2, verse 13 through 15. Or verse 12, we'll start there. Amazed and perplexed, this is the day of Pentecost, they asked one another, what does this mean? Some, however, made fun of them, or King James says, mocked, and said, they have had too much wine, or they're drunk. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Now also in verse 33 in his Pentecost sermon, it's interesting what he says. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit. He's talking about Jesus received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. I want to emphasize what you now see. Yes, tongues was a sign, but so was the behavior. So was what they were seeing that caused them to be accused of being drunk. There's things in God comes and renewal and revival that causes us to this very, very day to be amazed and perplexed and causes some to mock. Even today and throughout the history of the church. So I want to share with you just some testimonies. The power of the testimony. In March 1984, when Blaine Cook and a team from the Vineyard came to my Baptist church, in the invitation, when Blaine asked the Spirit to come, over here on the left was a backslidden woman. Doesn't even know why she came to the meeting. Hadn't been to church in months. And was actually backslidden. God and His grace came on her. And she came up. And a lot of people were trembling and shaking and crying. And lots of things were happening. And Blaine prayed this famous prayer that predated Toronto by at least 10 years. Which was, "More, Lord." And when he said, "More, Lord." Her name was Barbara. She hit the floor. And everybody's, it got worse. People were shaking harder, crying harder. But Barbara was knocked in the floor. She not only was knocked in the floor, but there's people around her. Her cousin, Tommy, my best friend, deacon in the church, we were afraid she was going to get stepped on. So we picked her up and we carried her into the choir. And we laid her down in a pew behind the first row. And that was around 9 o'clock. For the next 3 hours, every once in a while, you'd see Barbara come up. And back down, drunk at midnight, some friends had to drive her home. She was too drunk to drive. But that's not the only time. Jack Taylor's a father in this house too. In 1995 in Melbourne, Jack got so touched that on his way home, driving home, he got pulled over by the police. And the suspicion, drunk driving. because he literally was swerving backwards and forth. And they came in. They he's well known there. They recognized him. Well, Jack, what's going on? Where have you been? I've been to church. Well, Jack, did you realize you're swerving? And I don't know if this is getting to be a legend at this point. I don't know if he said, I'm not drunk as you suppose. My assistant pastor, when the Spirit fell in my church, in the Vineyard in 1993, after we'd come back from being at Rodney's meeting, on the way home, he's pulled over by the police because we needed designated drivers, but because he was actually swerving. When the power of God fell in Toronto in those first days, the camera guy, in that little storefront church, the camera guy, he's driving home in his Jeep, and he got the most, and the kids played with him all the time because he got the most bizarre anointing. Like, if you'd touch him, he'd go, and so the kids would come up to him and they'd touch him and go, and so he's driving home, and the police stop him. And they ask him for all of his papers and stuff, you know. He said, where you been? I've been at the church. He told me, he said, I'm so glad that police officer didn't touch me. I would have ended up, I'm sure, in jail. On that first night with Barbara, when her husband, Gene, was backslidden and me, full of bitterness and stuff from PTSD from Vietnam. He's worried about her because she's not home at 9 o'clock. And he knows what church is normally like. Starts at 7, gets out at 8. She wasn't home at 8, wasn't home at 9, wasn't home at 10, wasn't home at 11, at 12 o'clock. He's got in his car, his pickup. He's got, you know, Southern Illinois coal miner. He's got a shotgun up here behind him. He's got his cap on. He's got his snuff right here. And he's looking for his wife. And he's, you know, when you get scared, you can get mad. And he's mad. And he's driving out this lane out to the main road, and here comes his car. He gets out of the truck, runs over the car, and his wife isn't driving his car. And he says, where's Barbara? And about that time, she leaned up out of the back and said, hi, Gene! And he says, where have you been? Church! I've been to church. You don't get like this at church. Well, you do now, Gene. He just died laughing. And Gene got gloriously saved the next day. People said, this can't be right. This is not the way it ought to be. You shouldn't be having this much fun at church. The church is a very serious thing. This is not the right order. I like what Bonnke said. There's the order of the graveyard, and there's the order of a nursery. The order of the nursery is louder than the graveyard. I think of myself and my assistant pastor going to see Rodney in 93 in August. I've only been drunk in the Spirit 3 times. Total, 3 times. First one was when Rodney prayed for me. Well, I can think of 3, maybe more than 3, but not very many more than 3. And I watched my assistant pastor got touched first, and he couldn't hardly talk. His brain wasn't working right. It's like he couldn't think. And he was drunk. And then later, that I believe it was the next service, I got touched, and trying to walk home because we didn't have a car. We flew in, and I definitely had the poverty spirit. I have to confess it. I realized how much of poverty spirit I had. We weren't going to spend any money on a taxi when we could walk the mile back. And but I was afraid I was going to get picked up for drunk walking, because everything was funny. I finally got there, and I walked into the hotel, and I got my two friends with me, and I'm laughing, and some people were there, and they happened to be from the meeting. Said, "Oh, we know where you've been. You've been to church." I didn't understand it, and it was unusual. But what I know is this: it wasn't the first time I saw it. Because when I was 5 years old, in a little Baptist church in the country that was having a revival visitation of God, the first time I ever saw somebody with, we didn't call it holy laughter then, they called it getting happy. And it was my grandmother. She was illiterate. She was leading a testimony meeting and behind the pulpit, and all of a sudden it hits her. And she starts giggling and laughing and belly laughing to where she's actually bending over like this, coming up and laughing her head off. I'm watching my grandma, and I'm looking at my dad. I said, "What's wrong with grandma?" And he said, "It's the Lord." Well, that was really confusing, because up to that point, when the Lord would show up, Dad would start crying. Mom would start crying. And I was, "Dad, why is Mom crying? Why are you crying?" "Because we're happy." "Well, Daddy, if you're happy, why are you crying? I don't know how to explain it, but you'll understand it." "Well, I did. I got holy tears 1,000 times more than I ever got holy laughter." But I saw it when I was 5 years old, so I knew that this is not something that's new. As a matter of fact, when in Toronto, the Pentecostal, one guy in the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada wrote an article against Toronto, a lot of the elderly people wrote him back in the paper and said, "You don't even know your own history. When Pentecost came to Canada, there was not only tongues, but there was laughter in the meetings as well." In the Middle Ages, in the revivals in the Catholic Church, in the Middle Ages, when there's visitations of God, they called it sober intoxication. They called it jubilation. There were several names for this joyous laughter that was part of a visitation of God. So I think of what I've seen, and I get excited. Weird things, too, like in the October of 84, we were touched when Blaine came in March of 84. In October, he came back. Wimber's supposed to speak, but Wimber was sick and he couldn't do the healing meeting. I had to tell the press that he wasn't, our minister of healing isn't here because he's sick. And really what it was he was exhausted. I mean, Blaine told me, he said, "Randy, he just exhausted. He needs to sleep." And but anyway, that night, I was telling Alan about this afternoon at dinner. I mean, there was a boy that was carried out, and it was hours before he ever came to. But when the Spirit of God hit him and he's out, when his dad picked him up. Now, you know, you pick up a child, their legs, you know, you got them like this, their head would be like that, and their legs would be over here. They picked up that boy. He was as straight as a board, and he's out. I mean, his legs are sticking out. Everybody that saw that boy being carried out, he's about 11 years old, or 9 to 11 years old, was just looking and struck with amazement. What meaneth this? You know, what does this mean? What's going on? When Bob Bradbury, Captain Bob, who was the mentor of Will Hart, and Will has a special grace for praying for kids, when he came to my church in St. Louis, my teenagers and my children were so touched that they were weeping, stuck to the floor, laughing, shaking, all different ones doing different things. He had a special grace for that. When Blaine came to my Baptist church and we had those 3 days of meetings, it was awesome. But 2 weeks later, God shows up and touches my youth group. And we dismissed the service to go over to the building to have some refreshments, but I'd never seen this before. They don't want to research. They don't want to do refreshments. They don't want to do games because God has come upon them. I remember walking out to go out to that door, and I heard someone whimpering. And it was the, I mean, you don't mean a story, but the girl that was healed of the crossed eye and healed of spinal bifida and got control of her bladder, 14-year-old Tammy, and got healed of those seizures and got healed of the shunt in for hydrocephalic condition. It's her sister, Samantha, 11 years old. And I walked by what used to be my old office before we built the new building, and I heard her sitting in the dark. I turn on the light, and there she is, and she's crying. She's crying because she's scared. She's scared because she feels so much power in her hands. Her hands are just trembling like this, and it is totally new to us. And what's so amazing is her dad and her sister have been so healed now, the power of God's on her. And she says, I'm scared. This power is in my hands. I've never had my hands shake like this. They actually hurt. They feel like they've got electricity in them. I said, Samantha, this is God. And I brought her, took her by the hand, and I took her over into the educational building. And we went into one of the rooms, and I wanted the leaders of the church. So here comes one of my deacons. And he reaches, I said, Tammy, lift up your hand. And this deacon, this guy, he played fullback in high school football, fullback. She lifts up her hand, and you could just see him start going back like this. Here come another deacon, grabbed him. Now I got two deacons going. Here come another deacon, and I got three deacons all going down. And then the trustee comes, and I got four men, and she never touches any of them. She just keeps her hand like that, and they all get knocked down the floor. We had never seen that before. But it happened. That same night, one of my deacons, his wife, Tommy, his wife, we're praying for her because she has a problem in her joints. And we actually watched. It's the only time in my life I've seen this, only once in my life. I know others probably seen it a lot, but I had never seen it. And not only did I see it, it wasn't like I was seeing things in the spirit. It was something you could see with the natural eye because there's about three or four of us in that meeting. We literally saw this thing that looked flat, like maybe just like flat, like a piece of paper, about that big, dark, went out of her arm, went down her leg, and went into the onto the carpet and washed it. We watched it go out of the room. And when it happened, all of her pain left. We had never had that kind of anointing that would cause those afflicting spirits just start leaving. It was an amazing thing. Now, I know that this may, you say, you're talking about phenomena. I know, I'm talking about the power that causes the phenomena. I'm talking about the visitation of God. I'm talking about what begins to happen that is not normal when we have these special services when God comes. Now, that service got me in trouble because it didn't get over till 5 o'clock in the morning. And we're talking kids. One of them, 5-year-old Tommy's son, gave his life to the Lord. My son had severe asthma, and he was kind of hyper. And the Spirit of God came on him, and he went into a stupor. I mean, just for like a half an hour, he sits there, and he's not asleep, but he can't move. It went till 5 in the morning. Well, between that week and the next week, one of the men who did not like the moving of God called me and said, if you ever lay your hands on my kids, I'm going to beat the something out of you. And this guy had actually tried to pull me out of a car once and whip me another time because he didn't like what God was doing. Not everybody likes the moving of God. I'm just going to tell you that. Not everybody's going to agree with you that it's God. And so he had told me, don't you ever lay your hands on my two daughters. So the next Sunday night is a youth meeting. And the youth get up. They said, why don't you let the youth tell their testimony what happened last week? So they did. And as they started talking about it, it happened again. They started shaking again. And then they said, Brother Andy, that's what they call you in the Baptist church. Brother Andy, I think you should bring all the kids down here and lay your hands on them again, including that guy's two daughters. and I got a word of wisdom. I said, I don't think that that's what we're supposed to do tonight. I think that I'm going to call them all down here, and I want your mom and dad to come behind you, and you're going to lay your hands on them. And if your mom and dad is not here, your Sunday school teacher can lay. But I'm just going to stay up here. I'm not going to really lay my hands on anybody tonight. And this was so amazing because God did not do what I was expecting. I'm expecting we're going to ask the Holy Spirit to come, and this after when God touched the kids. But in times of visitation, there is this thing of kids preaching, kids quoting scripture, kids seeing visions, seeing things they don't know in the natural. And there's a history of it through all huge, major, major revivals. When the Spirit of God, after I was touched in Tulsa, I went home, and Susan saw that glory cloud roll in. And people came up. Nobody had ever fallen in the history of my church. 8 years, nobody. People are falling all over the place. As a matter of fact, that's the early service. When some of them started coming in, they weren't expecting somebody to be laying across the threshold of the church, and they stepped on them. And the Lord spoke to the person who got stepped on and said, get used to this. We had people get out. One man had been sexually raped by another man when he was a little boy. He didn't even want to be prayed for because he's against all of it. But I finally convinced him to let me pray for him because he's stuck. You know, he came up to take communion. You heard this story before? He came up to take communion because we did communion every Sunday. So he doesn't like anything that's going on. And he's been trained to be a lawyer. But he's not got through the bar yet, but he's through the education part. And so he goes over here and he takes communion. And he's thinking, I'm not going to let this stuff ruin me from take my communion. So he goes and takes communion and turns around like this. Now the line of people who come up for prayer is right there. And when he turns around, God freezes him. And he can't move his feet. Now I don't know that. I think he's in line. So I'm coming down the line. And I get to him, and he looks at me and said, I don't believe this is God. I said, well, if you don't believe it's God, why are you in the line? I'm not in line. I said, well, if you're not in line, why are you standing at the end of the line if you don't believe this is God? He said, because I can't move. And I said, what do you mean you can't move? I said, I that's exactly what I mean. I can't move my feet. It's like they're stuck. I want to move. I don't want to be here. But I can't move. So I said, listen, since you're not going anywhere, let me pray for you. And finally, I got him to say, okay. Now, if it starts playing a tune. So I began to pray. And some people just do not want to fall. I'm praying. His hands start shaking. Eyelids are fluttering. I keep praying, more, Lord, more. I keep praying, more, Lord, more. I don't touch him. I keep praying. He gets like this. He looks up. He's got fear on his face. He said, I can't stand up anymore. This is very painful. I'm trying as hard as I can to stand up, but this hurts. I said, why don't you lay down? He said, can I? I said, yeah, you don't have to get knocked down. Just lay down. So he laid down. And God stuck him to the floor for about 4 hours. Some of the people that happened at 8 o'clock, it was 4 p.m. before they could get off the floor. And this man that this sovereign thing was going on with, who was against it, didn't believe it was God, that didn't bother God. God's got big shoulders. He's not intimidated by our unbelief. He's big enough. We don't need to defend him. God starts taking him into visions of being raped and of other terrible things that had happened to him over the years. And God begins healing him sovereignly without anybody having to minister inner healing to him, because the master inner healing was doing it himself in the move of God. Now, okay. So August, September, October, 2 months later, we're at the regional meeting of the Vineyard, and they let me speak 5 minutes. I said this the other day, and I spoke an hour, and God comes. And the way we really knew it was, really, really knew this was God, more than anything else to me, for a lot of us, and this is kind of an in-house joke. But our regional overseer was sometimes nicknamed behind his back, Mr. Control. Name was Happy Layman, the regional overseer of the Vineyard. And when he was knocked down, and when he was on his back, and when he was rolling like this from side to side, laughing, and just all of us are bug-eyed and say, this has got to be God. He would never do that. And in the midst of it, my area coordinator had been in a very bad car accident, and he would wake up every morning in tears because of so much pain in his spine for over a decade. He came up for prayer. We prayed. God knocked him down. He came up again. God knocked him down. He came up again. This time, God knocked him back several feet, hit the wall, fell on the floor, instantly healed, and he never had that again. It was an amazing thing. You say, why would God be so rough? I don't know, but I think we really misunderstood when we told people all those years, God would never do anything to embarrass you. God is a gentleman. Sometimes he can be a gentleman, but I tell you, he can be a ruffian too. The second or third time that Heidi Baker in Toronto received a baptism spirit, it was the night we were praying for release of apostolic anointing. When that happened, she had slacks on. She said she's so glad she's delivered from some of the Pentecostal background that women couldn't wear slacks, because God knocked her down and flipped her up on her head, and then threw her down again, and flipped her up on her head, threw her down again. She told me, she said, Randy, I had bruises. It was violent. It literally was bruised. One time she felt like she's been suffocated just from the heat that was going on. Fire makes you hot. Power can make you shake. Love can make you cry. Joy can make you laugh. Sometimes he gives things in people's hands to be an encouragement to them. In 94, right before I went to Toronto, 2 weeks before, I get prayed for again by Rodney Howard Brown. Again, I'm knocked to the floor. Don't have time to tell the whole story, but at one point, my hand fell on my forehead. And when it did, it was ice cold. And I thought, what is this? Before, I'd had hands get hot. This time, they're ice cold. And I remember I'm laying on the floor, and I told the Lord I was going to wait till he touched me, even if I had to, the janitor had to get me off the floor. And my hands start getting weird and contorting and like getting all tight, this I can't make it, and turning like this, and they hurt from the power and are actually like blue purple, almost just cold, and it's like circulation shut off. And Rodney came down and put his hand in mine and said, this is the fire of God in your hands. I asked him, well, he said, why do you call it fire when it's cold? He said, I don't know, it's what my mom and dad called it. Sometimes we don't know why these things get started. But he did say, go home, pray for everybody. And I did. And we saw a breakthrough. For the first time in my life, like 90% of the people we prayed for just fell out of the power. I've seen that happen. Hands get like that. I don't know. Maybe 10 times, maybe 15. Not that many, considering the scores of thousands of people I've prayed for. But when I've seen that, there is almost always a correlation between a strong anointing for healing. Same way with oil. I remember Jack Taylor was with us. We were up in Vermont and with Captain Bob Bradbury, and got about 1,000 pastors there. And this little girl, 9 years old, she has oil form in her palms. And we lined up the pastors and had this little girl go and praying. And as she's praying, she put her hand on her forehead. And then after a while, it's all gone. And she'd come back to Captain Bob, who was a sea captain from Galilee, near Nazareth, Rhode Island. And in a meeting where he is my catcher for several days, several times over the next several months, he's my catcher. We're at Regent University. He's my catcher. And he hears the Lord say, he's making, in 1994, he's making $250,000 a year. That's his income. He has an airplane. He's got boats. He makes boats. He's a commercial fisherman, Captain Bob. And he hears the Lord say, lay down your nets, sell your boats, and come follow me. And this guy, who's an Episcopalian, who knows nothing about these things, he did that. He went home, sold his boats, quit his $250,000 a year job, and opened up the yellow pages to the churches and just started going down, calling the pastor, saying, hey, God's called me to preach. Can I come? We want your background. I'm Episcopalian. What experience? I never preached before in my life. And he just persistent. And it turned out he had such an anointing. He had no fear. He'd go in where the gangs were at, and the gang members start crying. He'd pray for the kids. It's an amazing thing that God was doing with Captain Bob. Well, he had seen this oil happen in Dominican Republic or somewhere in the Caribbean, so he was familiar with it. He said, that's anointing on her, and he's what got her to pray. And after her hands would go dry, she'd come back, and he'd pray for him, and you'd see the oil start forming again. A year ago, I was in Montana and praying for a church, and we saw this woman who's not in any leadership. And I stopped and I asked, do your hands sweat too much? Do you have overactive sweat glands? She said, no, I don't. I said, open your eyes, look at your hands. And it is puddled in her hands. It's a four-square denominational church. And the pastors told me there's like an anointing has come on her for healing. I told the story this week of a Baptist guy down in Brazil, not the first time, but the second time I see that happening in him. And I declare out loud, this guy's getting an anointing for miracles. He's had over 500 deaf ears open, over 500 blind eyes see. He's had over 500 tumors disappear. He's had over 100 people walk out of wheelchairs. I may have been 500, but I'll say 100. God told him, quit counting after he got to that point. But he never had those kinds of miracles like that until this phenomena had occurred. Now, there's people who have miracles that don't have those things. I just want to give us some context. If you're praying and you see something bizarre like that, that you have hope, faith, and can come in agreement and say, God, I bless this healing release in this person. I bless what you're doing. It comes to, I want to close here just soon by asking God to come. But I want to deal a little bit more with joy, because that's the thing that got us in so much trouble. The very first night of Toronto, when there's only 120 people there, there's this woman, her name is Carol Berg. I walked over to her. And I didn't know what all was going on. Some people were acting like flying, and people were stuck, and there were people in visions, and people were hopping, and people were, it was weird, and John and I, we didn't know what half of it meant. But this one woman, she's sitting on her seat, like there. And I went over, and I just felt like the Lord said, go pray for her. So I went over, and I prayed for her, and she fell out of her seat, and she's sitting on her butt, leaning up against the back, and she's just kind of giggling. And I walk away and I hear this. Go back and tell her she's been sad too long. I went back. I said, the Lord says you've been sad too long. And then I don't know why I did it, but I said, here, take another drink. And she gets drunk. I mean, really, really drunk. Crazy, laughing, and drunk. Oh, man, this is amazing. I really liked it. But over the next 20 years, every time I'd see her, she's still drunk. And I judged her. I actually thought she started out in the spirit, but she's ended up in the flesh because nobody can stay drunk that long. It's every time I see her, she's drunk. And I judged her. I was wrong, because when I wrote the book, There's More, I'd ask for people to send me their testimonies, and I got hers. And I remember reading her testimony. When you said I'd been sad too long, I'd been sad because I had two terminal illnesses. And I was an RN, and I'd been so sick for so many years. And when you're sick for so many years, you get depressed, and you can get sad. And it was actually now terminal, her case. And the joy of the Lord heals her body. I did not know that. I didn't know that she had developed her own healing ministry. I didn't know that she'd gone many times to the Scandinavian countries. I didn't know that one day she walked into this church and this young woman had just found out that her baby that was almost 9 months had died just a day or two before. And the doctors had told her, you're going to have a stillborn birth. There is no heartbeat. There is no movement. Your baby is dead. Carol does not know that. Nobody told Carol that. She walks into this meeting, and she walks over to this woman who's really, really pregnant, and she just walked over and laid her hands on her abdomen and said, I bless this baby that's in you. I bless God's purposes in this baby. And everybody else knows that baby's dead, but she doesn't. But 2 years later, when she came back to that church, that baby that was in that womb that came back to life when she blessed it, ran and jumped into Carol's arms. A miracle baby. And Carol, I found out, she wasn't drunk all the time. It's just every time she got around me, she'd get drunk. I remember one time, this is one of the other few times I got drunk. I was in Las Vegas. What stays in Vegas happens in Vegas, stays in Vegas. Anyway, I was in Vegas, a large Assembly of God church. And I don't think I've ever been this drunk in my life in the spirit. And I've only been drunk one time by alcohol. And that was when I was backsliding at 18 years old, right before I came back to the Lord. But anyway, it's the pastor's wife. I don't know who she is. But she is so drunk, and I'm so drunk, they're having to hold me, and by hanging on to me, my sweater's just got all these little balls on it where they was hanging on to me. I tried to lean on it. I was out of my mind drunk, and so was she. And she's falling on the floor, laying in place. So the next day when I sobered up, I said, who was that woman that was? Was she the local church drunk? And they said, no, that's the first time and the only time she's ever been like that. That's the senior pastor's wife. But it did produce a great fruit. Holy tears, holy laughter. Whatever he does becomes holy. Whatever he causes becomes holy. The danger we sometimes face is to try to manufacture in the flesh what was a move and work of God. I don't want us to do that, but neither do I want us to resist anything. Here's what I've seen. Sometimes God's coming on somebody, and they don't know how to receive, or they want to stay in control. Self-control was one of the fruits of the Spirit. It's a good thing, but you know, you can use your self-control to say yes. You can use your self-control to say, Lord, if I start to tremble, I'm not going to try to gain control and stop it. If I begin to feel you pressing against me, because I was this way. I always thought I was a hard-to-receive person because people pray for me. I'd feel this pressure from behind, and I would go like this, and I would curl my toes and tighten up everything behind me because I thought like you were supposed to try to stand up. I didn't know I should use my self-control and say, I'm not going to fake it. But I'm not going to resist it. And so I thought I was hard to receive until one of my friends in my church, a layman, said, next time the Spirit of God comes like that on you, don't fake it, but don't try to stop it. See if you really are hard to receive. I found out I wasn't hard to receive at all. I just didn't know how to receive. We don't want the flesh of faking it. But there can be a flesh of wanting to stay in control so you don't lose your dignity or whatever. Or there's a time, well, that's what was happening 20 years ago, but we're past that now. I just want to ask the Holy Spirit to fall upon this congregation. And it may be like some people that's been in our meetings that literally they were opened their eyes to see angelic beings. It happened in 84 in my Baptist church. It happened in Brazil several times to people where they, after this experience, they could see the angelic realm. And it caused a big breakthrough in their life. Lots of diversity. Lots of things. We're not really after any of those things. What we're after is a visitation. A face and hand together. Of knowing Him. And the power of His resurrection. That what happened in Cedar Church 2 weeks ago would happen here at New Life City Church. That there would be a release and an impartation that would come. What's really interesting, I want to share this just to build your faith up. My wife asked me that night how I felt that service went 2 weeks ago. And I said, it's okay. She said, what do you mean it's okay? I said, I mean, it wasn't a bad service. It's a good service. It just wasn't a great service. When you've seen some of these things, you have a high watermark that gets really high. And I'm thinking, I've seen more than I saw tonight. And here's what I want to confess to you. That I was paying too much attention to the manifestations because I thought the greater the manifestation, the greater the power. Because that really, 2 weeks ago, there's people fell. But I have seen much stronger things. But I don't know hardly, it's like maybe three churches that's had that kind of anointing. One of them was Reading, one of them was Tom Jones's church, one of them was Henry Madava's church in Ukraine, and now Sidra. The point I want to make was this. I would not have guessed that kind of fruit would have come out of those kinds of manifestation. I would have thought it's going to have to be stronger than that, and I was wrong. So I want to minister in faith tonight, not looking to what I see in the natural, but believing that God's starting to do something in our family of churches, and He wants to do something with you. And as you're about to step into a bigger location, He's about to make sure that you're going to fill it up. Amen. And so I want to ask everybody here to stand. And we're going to do two things. We're going to ask God to come. And I know there's some of you, maybe you came because you need to be prayed for healing. And we've prayed for healing. But at the very end, we're also going to lay hands on people. The ministry team can help me. But before we do that, more important than an individual healing tonight, and I believe that's more individual healing is going to happen, is for the church to receive a corporate anointing to where that you begin to say what Bill said before we went there. They were having healings on a weekly basis. But after that night, they began to have healings on a daily basis as the church was scattered throughout work. I want you to lift up your hands like this. And I want to pray for you. If the power of God begins to come upon you with energy, heat, electricity, weeping, joy, a heaviness coming upon you, that you'd step up to the front. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you, would do this again. What we have seen you do in other places, I ask you to do it here tonight. Lord, I pray that, like Paul said to the Ephesians, not to be drunk with wine, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. like Jesus said, that rivers of living water would flow out of us, that we were invited to come and drink. Lord, that there'd be a drinking in the souls of people, a drinking of the outpouring of your Spirit. Even as Paul said to the Corinthians, that we've all been given the one Spirit to drink. As John in the book of Revelation talked about, that the Spirit had been poured out and we could come freely to drink. We pray for new wine. We pray for the refreshing. We pray for angels to come. We pray for strength, and we pray for commissionings. So now, Lord, we're just going to wait on you. Come, Holy Spirit. Jesus' name. More, Lord. More, Lord. More, God. I bless his hands, Lord. Man, there's an anointing coming out. Yeah, that man there, there's an anointing coming on his hands. I bless it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Increase. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. More, Lord. More, God. We bless what you're doing. In the name of Jesus. More, God. More for the nations. More for the trips. More for her role in leadership. God, I pray that you let an... I pray for an impartation, Christine. An impartation to come for impartation. An impartation of faith to believe God will use you to release into the team when they come an impartation. We bless her, God. Increase it. Increase the anointing in the name of Jesus. More, Lord. We bless her. Bless her, God. Bless her, Lord. In Jesus' name, bless him, God. In the name of Jesus. More, 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 Lord. Fill them up, God. Fill them up, Lord. Fill them up, God. God, thank you for healing his ears. I bless his hands. Do it to him and do it through him. In the name of Jesus. More, God. Bless him. Fill her up, God. Fill her up, Lord. God, do it to the kids again. Do it to the teenagers. Do it to the children. In the name of Jesus, God. Bless him. God, I bless this baptism of love. Holy tears and a baptism of love upon her. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, bless this boy. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. More, God. More, Lord. Yeah. More, Lord. More, God. I bless your hands in Jesus' name. I bless your hands in Jesus' name. Bless the power of God on you. In the name of Jesus. More, God. Fill her up, Lord. Fill her up, God. Fill her up, God. More. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. More, Lord. Bless her. In the name, the glory, the weight. You feel that weight? I see it on you. I bless it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Release gifts of healing. in the name of Jesus. Release prophecy, release visions, release gifts. God, we call forth for prophetic gifts of revelation of both words of knowledge and prophecy to be here in the church and on the streets. Gifts of faith and gifts of healing in the name of Jesus. Bless them, Lord. Fill him, God. Fill her, Lord. In the name of Jesus. More, God. More, Lord. More, God. More, Lord. God, I bless the woman right there. You're her husband? Tell her I'm praying for her. That's the Spirit of God's on you. I bless it in that woman right there, too. Spirit of God's on you. I just bless what he's doing in your life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I bless the power that's starting to flow through your body right now in the name of Jesus. More, God. More, Lord. More, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, we thank you. We bless what you're doing. We bless the woman in blue with the red hair right there, you. I bless what he's doing in Jesus' name. I bless your hands. I bless your body. I bless your spirit in the name of Jesus. More, Lord. We bless your presence here in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. More, God. More, Lord. More, Lord. More, God. We bless him, God. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you for that new hip. God, you did it to him. Now do it through him. Many people, majority of the people I know who have strong healing anointings, they got healed themselves. And it's kind of like their own healing just kind of released something in them. I bless you. In Jesus' name, touch him, God. Touch him, Lord. Touch him, God. Touch him, God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I bless your hands. Jesus' name. More, God. More, Lord. Increase your anointing, God. Release. Release, God. We bless what you're doing. We bless what you're doing. We bless what you're doing. I'm just going to, you know, Bill sometimes had you to turn to somebody and pray for him. If you're not sensing too much happening to you, just go ahead and open your eyes and look around you. If you see somebody the Spirit of God's on, just turn your hand toward them. If they're trembling, bless the power. If they're crying, bless the love. If they're giggling, bless the joy. And just bless what he's doing. More, God. More, Lord. More. Because God's touching people throughout this room, and I can't get to them fast enough. So help me. More, God. We bless him. Bless him, God, in Jesus' name. Bless him, Lord. In Jesus' name. Man, and this boy, is this your son? Or this boy? Wow. Does anybody know who?